Hello and welcome to diverCity. I'm Ryan Chua.
And I'm Kaylee Monahan. This week's top stories are the UN Conference on Climate Change,
the reopening of Tate Britain,
a profile on campus pub security,
and this week's international football game. We begin with the March Against Mainstream Media, which took place on November 16 in more than 400 locations around the world.
In the UK, the Occupy London movement hit the capital.
Now, just how sick and tired are people of the alleged lies and biased coverage of some media corporations? Liana Kajarova reports.
Last Saturday, about 100 of people gathered on Portland Place outside the BBC Radio to express their protest against the mainstream media. The march was organized by the Occupy London activist group, known for their demonstrations against economic inequality.
We take climate change seriously.
According to George Bardet, the peace campaigner of the Occupy movement, BBC doesn't provide people with fair coverage of really important issues, such as, for instance, climate change.
There was a Question Time episode 2 nights ago. One of the main voices talking about climate change was Nigel Lawson, who was Margaret Thatcher's Chancellor of the Exchequer, who's effectively doing the bidding of the fossil fuel industry, is lying to people about the science of climate change.
Carrie-Anne Mendoza, the social blogger, pointed out in her speech that the content of BBC is shaped by people who have financial and personal interest in maintaining an unjust status quo.
So if we're going to have a public broadcaster, I want one that is independent politically and financially from all of those vested interests. And right now, BBC, which is led by a Conservative peer and a paid employee of big energy companies, BP and EDF Energy.
The main concern of most of the protesters is that paying their license doesn't pay off. However, it is always about your personal choice.
I don't pay. Never did, never will.
They're getting thousands and thousands of pounds every year in bonuses. I'm sorry, but my license fee is not going towards that.
The march attracted a lot of activists from different movements and lasted for about 4 hours. However, BBC press office refused to comment on the event. Liana Kajarova, diverCity.
The UN Conference on Climate Change took place only a few days ago, just after a massive storm hit the Philippines, killing thousands.
The Philippine representative to the talks was emotional as he asked the world to take stronger steps against climate change. Here's my report from Warsaw, Poland.
This is what's left of many parts of central Philippines after the most powerful storm in history to make landfall unleashed its fury. At the UN Climate Conference in Warsaw's National Stadium, images of Typhoon Haiyan's devastation were in Philippine Climate Change Commissioner Nadirev Yebsanyo's thoughts as he tearfully appealed to the world for tougher steps against climate change.
The devastation is staggering. I struggle to find words even for the images that we see on the news coverage. And I struggle to find words to describe how I feel about the losses. We can fix this. We can stop this madness.
Mr. Sanyo announced that he's fasting until he sees meaningful progress in the talks, a move that other delegates followed. The Philippines and other developing nations are pushing for a system that will require rich and industrialized countries with the highest greenhouse gas emissions to compensate for the losses and damage that the poor ones suffer due to global warming.
Now, this is just one of the pleas of developing countries, countries that are so vulnerable to calamities despite not having enough to withstand them, unlike their rich neighbors. They hope it wouldn't take another Haiyan for the world to listen to them.
Developing countries also want the developed world to put money into a fund for climate change adaptation. These proposals have been in the talks for many years, but have seen little progress.
It's really a big struggle and a challenge because they don't want to comply and they are backtracking here and there.
Some negotiators from developing countries have expressed their frustration days before the conference draws to a close.
You cannot blame us for being impatient. We cannot go on negotiating every year without concrete action to avoid further warming.
Scientists have yet to find a direct link between climate change and extreme weather conditions like storms, but many agree that a warmer planet makes calamities stronger and more destructive, possibly even more than Haiyan was. Reporting from Warsaw, Brian Chua, diverCity.
Last Thursday, the buildings in London turned blue to bring awareness to diabetes. But how many people are actually aware of this? We sent our reporter, Mary Axiendo, to find out.
I'm standing here in Trafalgar Square, where the two fountains are lit up in blue. The Mayor of London, Boris Johnson, has taken this decision in honor of an appeal by the Silver Star Diabetes Charity. This is also done in an effort to strengthen recognition of the blue circle as the national symbol of diabetes.
Do you know why the fountains are lit up in blue?
No, I don't.
No, I don't know.
World Diabetes Day is celebrated each year on November 14. On that day, iconic buildings all over the world are lit up in blue. This is done in an effort to raise awareness for the condition suffered by millions of people worldwide. At the request of the Silver Star Diabetes Charity, Mr. Speaker John Bercow has lit up the Elizabeth Tower in the London Eye in blue. Are people aware of this?
Do you know why London Eye is lit up in blue today?
Let me see, maybe about the Christ?
Charles' birthday!
At a time when 3 million Britishers are estimated to die from diabetes every year, it seems that the general public has no idea that today is World Diabetes Day. Perhaps societies need to do more to increase awareness. Dr. Motvadia, chairman of the Trustees for Silver Star Charity, believes that the levels of awareness about diabetes have indeed been raised, though they need to be sustained.
The levels of awareness are quite reasonable at the moment. Awareness is not only about how to detect diabetes, but also how to prevent it and change it. There is charity work being done. They expect people to go to their GPs or walk-in centers. In that sense, it will go in the minds of individuals and they will be thinking about it.
Tate Britain is unveiling the results of its £45 million renovation.
The project involves the reopening of its Thames-facing entrance and a new spiral staircase. Catherine Liu has this report.
Today, the new Tate Britain is unveiled to the public. The renovation includes the reopening of the main entrance to Tate Britain on Mill Bank, a stunning new spiral staircase, the new learning studios. The whole project spent £45 million. Does it worth such huge money? Different people have different ideas.
I was quite surprised to hear the cost of £45 million is a lot of money, and I really feel this time in this country we're in a really big recession, and I think there are a lot of people out there that really could do with this kind of funding.
You know, when you're talking about culture, how can you say no to it's like an investment. I think it's a lot of money, but I think at least in the long term, it might be worth it because it's for the public. It's not something that I think it's money well invested.
However, the new Tate Britain has become far more welcoming
because we can see the whole history of art in Britain through, you know, the displaying paintings here.
Pretty, and like the paintings are really like there's so much contrast. And like the ages of the paintings.
Catherine New, diverCity, London.
One of City University's librarians will soon celebrate an important milestone in her life. Here's Sarah Shirai with a report.
The City Library is one of the main pillars of our university. Today, we talk to Sheila Manton, who has been working here for the past 4 decades.
So in what year did you join? 1973, 1st of November 1973. Only on a 1 year contract, but then somebody left to have a baby, so I became permanent.
Her favourite bit of the job are the students. From meeting the love of her life to being the Chinese disco champion, she reminisces over the days gone by at the City Library.
It's been so rewarding working with students. And it's changed through the years. When I started off, it was very open. We were only on the top two floors. And lots of lecturers just wander in, you know, because they had to use the card catalogue. They look at the journals, the paper journals. I'm just coming out, have a nap, you know, nothing to do with the library. So it was really neat. You felt that such a nice atmosphere. So we got to know, you know, staff and students very well. Certainly in those years I got to know people very, you know, it was like being a student in a way without the homework, you know, because I could go, I went to the, they had wonderful sort of student events. A lot of the societies from different countries would have events, and they'd make their own food. Right. In those days, they could bring in their own food, but that was banned anyway. And I was a Chinese disco dancing champion once, and things like the Egyptian society had very posh do's in the great hall with belly dancers and musicians. Wow. And I remember round tables with candles on, but very posh. So it was all sorts of different things.
Sheila, who planned on retiring soon, however, has one last mission on her hands. Saving the graduate library.
Yes, that's a real shame that's because that used to be the new hall. In fact, that's where I saw George Melly and various other people. We used to get groups and things coming in, certainly in the 70s. And of course, it was the uni at the student bar, and then it came the graduate library. It's great. I really feel I'm so lucky to have been able to work here for 40 years.
We wish Sheila the very best. That's all from me, Sarakshi Rai, diverCity News, London.
Have you ever seen a fight at Sadler's? No? Exactly.
Our reporters Jade and Sophia interview the gatekeepers of our beloved bar. Now beware, you may never look at them the same way again.
You know them. You love them. You probably show them your student card over 50 times.
But what makes the Sadler security guard so special? That's what we're here to find out.
When they say, what's my name? I say, Cola. They say, what? I say, okay, Coca-Cola. When you remember Coca-Cola, you remember my name is Cola.
They are talking about
me. You see this man? You know he's a very good singer. Everything in
life, feel me. I do dance because I'm a social man. Okay? I have a lot of sociality in me.
First of all, very popular. Some people used to take pride in carrying my tracksuit on their shoulder.
Oh my gosh, yes. You were a legend.
Oh, legend, original.
So there you go. They were a bit shy at the beginning. They think of the students as their own kids and they give them advice about girls and they gossip with them sometimes too.
And they used to be students themselves, so they feel comfortable in our environment.
Don't get pissed off when they ask you for your student's card. It's for your own security and your own safety. And they do care. Sophia Bettiza.
Jay Garcia.
diverCity.
That's all the stories we have for this week. Thank you for tuning in.
Don't forget to follow us on Facebook and Twitter. I'm Ryan Chua.
And I'm Kaylee Monahan.
See you next week.